it's time to start the next talk. And with me here, I have Johan Thelin, or as we say in Sweden, Johan Thelin.
Thank you.
Who is going to talk about Qt-based GENIVI stack, and I'll let him explain the details about that. But I want to share with you an anecdote about Johan. He's been around for a long time in the Qt world, and at one point he came up with a brilliant idea. What if we just wrapped Qt with a GTK API? So he did that, and he actually managed to run some GTK applications on top of Qt instead. And I think that's a great way to earn your fame in the Qt world, right? So, Johan.
Thank you. Yes, I was actually able to run the examples from the GTK tutorial with just modified headers calling Qt calls underneath. Good fun project this summer. But yes, a Qt-based GENIVI stack. I thought I'd start just telling people who I am. Is there a problem with the microphone? No? Okay. I work with a company called Pelagicore. I have some automotive background. I've worked as a consultant for a long time. I worked with Nokia and Trolltech. I wrote a book about Qt 4.2, which still sells because it's the newest one. There hasn't been a book since. But I worked with Qt for 10 years and as an engineer for 15, 16 years, something. And I work at this company, Pelagicore, that was founded in 2009. I joined them a couple of months later. I work at the Gothenburg office, which is our the main office where we started. We also have the pleasure of working together with the Munich team, who consists of former trolls. And we work with open source infotainment, and our slogan within that is enabling great design. So we're really pushing Qt to make new, good-looking UIs, fluid and all of that. We really like Qt Quick. We have a history within automotive before Pelagicore, with the same management and engineering team. We worked with a number of vendors. So, I'm going to agree with the previous speaker. There is a lot changing in this industry. We see a cost ratio between hardware and software changing. You're no longer buying a radio with a couple of knobs on it and a little microcontroller. The software makes up a substantial part of the investment. It takes a lot of effort to do a modern head unit. In the old days, you usually bought a box from tier one that worked. It was pre-equipped with all the software and fulfilled the specifications. But the software turns out to be more and more OEM specific. As you go more and more visual, you add more and more of the brand identity. A BMW head unit looks like a BMW head unit. A Volvo head unit looks like a Volvo head unit. So the software is very much associated with OEM. There is little reuse. So some obvious business questions pops up. Who owns the software? Shouldn't OEM own its software? Should it pay to redevelop the same software over and over again from different hardware vendors? And who should actually make that software? Should the hardware maker make the software? Should the OEM make the software? Should there be another type of T1 that actually only does software? And in addition to these business and cost related issues, we have the pesky apps, the user expectations. My phone does all of this, why doesn't my car do that? And all that brings when it comes to legal matters, developer lifetime, and all the issues with the car being old and a phone being new every year. We have the user itself. Roaming profiles is something that would be good. If you have all your settings, all your music, everything associated with your BMW car key, why wouldn't you want to get a new BMW and just bring your key and the profile's there, the car's set up for you, the seat is in the right position, everything. You might have multiple cars in the family. If there is a way to tie the profiles to the car, you would want those cars to be of the same brand. Rental cars, you prefer the same brand as usually. Carpooling is becoming more and more popular in certain areas of the world. And I have the associated business questions again. Who owns the user? Should be Google, who owns everything. As for with Android and them providing the cloud services, should be the OEM, should be another party. Again, business opportunities and business problems, headaches. And then you have the whole prospect of selling more stuff. Since you have a platform that needs to be able to handle dynamic contents like applications, so how do you charge for an application? I wouldn't be happy as a customer if I was forced to pay extra to use the tuner in the car. So that's obviously something you want software for. So where is the user ready to pay? Where is the user not ready to pay? Is it a good proposition to sell, for instance, Angry Birds to your card and to your phone? Or do you only want one copy of that software, so to speak? Do you want to sell vehicle functions? We see more and more a single engine block with different configurations software-wise, different tunings. Would you like to buy some extra horsepower for your vacation when you have to pass through Germany? Do you want to buy the European maps and only have the Swedish one when you drive at home? And so on. Having the right business plan there could really make you able to monetize through the whole lifetime of the vehicle. And then we have the deployment scenario. Classically, we have the instrument clusters. This is actually from Electronica last year, a demo setup that we helped with. So we have an instrument cluster up in the front. We had a heads-up display, so the center stack, which is behind the car seat there. We have the rear seat entertainment nodes, and yeah, you have lots and lots of screens to handle. And then you also have multiple joined setups. For instance, this is a Mercedes concept car with a big screen here. So you simply merge the whole screen estate with all the opportunities and problems that brings. And this is a place where you can cut costs. So this is important to do the OEMs. Could you reduce the number of CPUs in the car by driving fewer screens or driving multiple screens from one node and so on? That makes sense, but you also don't want to have the big CPU in all cars and only differentiate on the screens, because then you have the cost of the high-end CPU. So this is another configuration problem. And back to the apps again. I wouldn't call it apps per se, but it's a word that everybody understands. So downloadable dynamic content, it could be data for apps, it could be data for the powertrain and so on. It opens new ways to make money, and you can grow the platform over time. You might be able to reuse part of the software over the lifetime of the vehicle. But how do you validate that? You have the security aspect, you take a legal responsibility that the car isn't dangerous. Your instrument cluster can't crash while you're driving, things like that. You have legal requirements from driver distraction and things like that, boot up times and availability times. You have to be responsive in certain systems. You can't have too much latency between something actually happening and that being reflected in an instrument. You have the whole indemnification problem. Who can you deal with? Who can actually bear the cost of a recall and things like that? And who develops the apps? Is it the OEM itself? Is it financed by the OEM? Is it a true third-party ecosystem, or is it what we usually call a second-party ecosystem, so still a controlled, supported set of developers? There are lots and lots of business problems to address within the automotive space. And that also means lots and lots of opportunities, because if you can provide the correct solution, you have new business. And this is where GENIVI enters the picture. I just took the charter from the homepage here and tried to highlight a couple of words. I'm going to do what I'm told never to do, read out loud from a slide. But GENIVI is an industry alliance that works to have a broad adoption of open source in infotainment system. IVI is a common abbreviation for infotainment, so that's why GENIVI. They drive requirements. They drive reference implementations of those requirements. They offer certification programs, and they want to foster a Qt or an open source IVI community. I'd like it to be a Qt IVI community. They want to drive an ecosystem building all the commodity software. And the goal of this is, of course, time to market, reduced costs, all that that brings. Why should everybody re-implement the wheel every project? And why should the OEMs have to pay for that every time? GENIVI is split into a number of expert groups, and these are committees. So it's nice to have the Wikipedia reference to design by committee sometimes when life feels difficult. But these are basically the forums where you discuss the various issues, the impacts on automotive, the available open source solutions, and basically make the choices to build the certification requirements. The open source part of GENIVI. GENIVI is an open source organization, but it's not a developer organization. It's not as easy as the Qt project where you simply contribute by writing code. We try to build standard instead. So what we want to do is we want to specify a Linux-based system for IVI use. We want to reduce the fragmentation, reduce the cost, reduce the reusability of what we have. We also want to utilize existing functionality. There are a number of media playback frameworks, so if we all can agree on using GStreamer, then we save a lot of time because we know what we find when you move software components in between platforms. And we want to utilize the common needs we have with other verticals. You see smart TVs built on Linux. I have an LG TV with the GPL printed in the back of the manual. If we need the same functionality in a car, we should simply reuse that. So we're working towards compliance. There is an ever-evolving compliance specification. It's at version 4 now. It's going to be updated to version 5 soon. It specifies what components to use for what purpose. So it's a requirement specification, a bit like Linux standard base, that you should have a Linux kernel, you should have a C library, all those things. And the components can either be placeholders. You should have something handling the compositioning of the screen. That should be a component. It could be an abstract component. That's just the interfaces. Drop whatever you like in here, but these interfaces should be available so that we can easily integrate and move components in between systems with various abstract components, and it can be specific. So for instance, we say you shall use system D of this version. And then these can be mandatory or optional. There is nothing forcing a software implementer to use these interfaces, but they must be provided. So you can have your own custom system and just add the GENIVI APIs on top of it, so that when an alien component is added to the system in a specific project, the APIs are there, so it's easy to integrate. But you can take any shortcut you like underneath, under the hood. There is also work towards splitting the specification, so that you can say for navigation you need these subcomponents, for hands-free you need these subcomponents. And that's a way to drive things towards specific, or at least towards abstract, and to make more components mandatory. Because right now you don't know if the car needs navigation, so we can't make it mandatory to provide navigation APIs, and the same for every subsystem. It's just a way to make as much as possible mandatory and of the highest possible class, so to speak. The best is a specific component, because then there's zero cost. You simply bring that part in. Something that's new, work in progress, is the same thing for apps. This is far, far, far from done. There is a trademark registered that's called Works with GENIVI. The purpose is to be able to move apps in between platforms, to have like a minimal set of APIs that are supported, so that you can move your commodity apps in between platforms. This is, of course, topic for long discussions, since there is no agreement on which framework to use, which language to use, which APIs that needs to be standardized, and so on. But it's a long-term goal. Then when it comes to all these components, the goal is, of course, to adopt components, to simply specify that you should use this open source component. I just briefly looked at the specification requirements. For instance, conman is required, BlueC is an abstract. You should fulfill the APIs of BlueC, but you don't have to have BlueC in there. Systemd, you need to have a Linux kernel, you need to have. And then there's requirements for these, that they should be configured in specific ways. So there are a number of patches that has to come with the Linux kernel, for instance. It should be the right version and things like this. And the idea here is to be a good open source contributor, to play with upstream projects and make adaptations to the automotive use case. In addition to this, there is open source development work taking place. Automotive embedded software isn't the obvious playing ground for all the open source hackers. I've seen it's more and more popular to build a car computer, but that's something more like an aftermarket system, something you add to the car. You don't have to fulfill the requirements of an actual production part for a car. So GENIVI is driving the development and sometimes even paying for it for specific components that they want to see, and they don't see any alternatives within open source. So for instance, you have the audio manager, which handles all the funny use cases where you might have an amplifier with some codecs on it. You have a head unit, you have rear seat systems, you need to lip sync in between all of those. You might have headphones over Bluetooth or some IR channel and so on. It's meant to handle the complex audio routing use cases in a car. You have diagnostic log and trace, which helps you do remote diagnostics, basically read logs. But you can also write plugins for it and have a mechanism to prod at the system, to actually make calls in the system through a standardized tool. You have layer management. That's a funny part. Usually in automotive, you have graphical layers that are managed hardware-wise. So you don't do all the compositioning in Wayland or some other composer software-wise. And that's a lot of that is due to the boot up requirements. You might want to have a video stream at the bottom. Yeah, exactly. The rear view, for instance, you need to have it up in, what do you say, 2 seconds? Yeah. I've seen lower requirements down to 1 or even 0.5 seconds. But you need to have video up and running very quickly. And then you want to be able to start your UI on top of that. So there is APIs for handling these layers of UI. And then there are changes made or development made that aren't only for automotive. For instance, you have AF bus, which is D-bus optimizations. It's a new bus system within the Linux kernel to reduce the latency over D-bus. Tracker IVI is a project that we're pushing from within Pelagicore. It takes Tracker and their file indexing engine and actually breaks it down into steps so that we can have a first response much quicker. So when you plug in the USB stick for the first time, you get the file names and then you get the metadata. Because earlier, and for the desktop case, you plug it in and then you wait a couple of seconds and then you have the metadata and the search is done. Was that a question?
Yes.
Then you need a microphone. You find the on switch?
Where?
Back there.
Speaking of D-bus, there are new initiatives trying to get a new speed up.
From Pottering and...
Yes. And do you know, is there anything, or what would be, if there's something going mainline, what do you think would be the GENIVI lines saying to that?
GENIVI would go with the mainline.
Okay.
They tried to mainline AF bus and have had it rejected. Yes. So it's part of a patch in the compliance right now. But if Pottering, for instance, or anybody else could get a D-bus routing function into the kernel to avoid, I think the biggest problem is the context switches between the sender, the daemon, and the receiver. So you have double context switches going each way. If somebody could reduce that and beat AF bus, of course, GENIVI would go mainline. The purpose is to maintain as little code as possible. one part of what GENIVI does. There's a web link there as well, with a list of all the projects. There are some others as well for startup management, which is sensitive since you need to start up things in the right order. And for shutdown management, to actually remember which order is relevant, which application was visible last, and which was audible last, and so on. So you can make those decisions. But one thing that automotive loves is communication buses. Because I think this is the level that the OEMs have been working on earlier. Which functions do I put in which little tin box? And how do I make them talk to each other? There are loads of buses in cars. There's CAN that everybody knows, LIN, which is a lightweight bus, a serial bus, MOST, FlexRay, Ethernet, D-Bus. I mentioned that there because in an AUTOSAR stack, which is a standard for building truly embedded non-Linux real-time systems for automotive, you actually configure the buses even within the ECUs, so you can move the software components in between the ECUs, more or less. And basically you want to be able to move these components freely and have a common bus. So you need not only to specify the components and the interfaces, but you also need to separate the component APIs from the actual IPC mechanism. So there's been work within a project called Franca IDL, which is a language used to describe component interfaces. This is a project driven within the Eclipse family of tools. So you get a model describing the Franca component, and then you can do transformation on it and actually generate code. So what you do generate is headers from common API that wraps a common API runtime that actually implements the IPC mechanism. So the reference case is based on D-Bus. So you take Franca and you generate an API towards D-Bus. But the funny thing is, it's possible to replace that D-Bus part without changing the ABI towards the applications. So you could build your D-Bus-based system, compile it for the correct, with the right tool chain and right kernel version and those things. And then you can replace the IPC mechanism by changing the runtime. We've also played around with this, so we have a Qt wrapper, a Qt generator. I have another question. Down there. I think it's off. Let's try again.
Thank you. I would like to know how Franca is different from, well, I've seen many IPC abstractions in the last 30 years. So what's the main reason to do yet another IPC abstraction? We have D-Bus as such, which is actually could be made transport independent. We have Corba. We really had a lot during the last 30 years. So why yet another?
I'm not the right person to defend Franca, I think. To be honest, what I hear is that D-Bus does not have the all of the attributes that you can express in Franca, for instance. I would imagine that Corba is too heavyweight, but I'm not the right person to defend Franca. But one of the funny things about this whole Franca over D-Bus is that it is actually Franca over D-Bus, so you cannot describe a D-Bus API and then only use Franca in one half. You don't build a D-Bus API that you can talk to directly, so to speak. You need the common API bindings on both sides.
But this means that you are actually abusing D-Bus as a transport layer. And this is horribly inefficient, and that in the next step, of course, you need to improve the efficiency of D-Bus. That's logical, but if you use Franca on both sides, on the server side and on the client side, you can use much more efficient existing transport mechanisms, definitely. Yes. Because, there's a myriad of issues if you do it this way.
Yes. And what we're actually seeing also is that when you see the upgrades of common API, they start to support more and more of the free desktop parts of Dbus, so to speak. So they support the properties interface now with version 2.1, I think it was. Don't quote me on that one. But there is also the ability to use more direct IPC mechanisms. We're doing that when integrating towards AutoSAR, for instance. Then we're using a wire protocol directly that AutoSAR uses. And then we don't get a string-based protocol, and then it's actually quicker than Dbus out of the box. Something interesting from a Qt perspective is that when you have the IDL, you can do exactly what you do for Dbus. You can create wrapper objects that are basically Q objects, and you can just listen to signals and slots and call methods. That is not released yet.
So I was just wondering if that Qt wrapper is going to be released as open source at some point, so everybody could use it.
I hope so, as a developer. It's in the layer where we aim to provide open source component. We have a layered architecture, and we can see where we differentiate commercially and when knowledge is the value, so to speak. So open source is a good idea for our part, and this is in the part where we want to go open source. It's not mature enough, I can tell you. There are some parts of Franca that aren't supported yet.
My question is, I've been working for some time now in a supposedly GENIVI compliant platform, and for example, I've worked a lot with Audio Manager over the Dbus, and so is Franca will be the, let's assume for example, is the Franca the main GENIVI compliant interface or is it the Dbus? Which one is it?
2 weeks ago, Audio Manager made a new release where Franca is the supported API. So,
So my question is, you make up an alliance. Of course, the parties represented or having the more muscle within the alliance will be more able to push the preferred solutions by them. How do you plan really to avoid fragmentation if you, for example, fix the interface to specific software or and somebody else doesn't like it, like or thinks something else would be better?
You only have to provide the APIs of GENIVI and make sure they work, of course, but you don't have to use them internally. So you can have an internal mechanism that is better, and then you use the GENIVI APIs for compliancy. Of course, in the ideal world, it would be the best solution to actually use the GENIVI APIs. Have a question behind?
I would like to comment on the open source issue. Honestly, when you do an open source project and you might consider doing some parts proprietary, that's fine and it works. But if you add proprietary licensing to a critical component, or especially to infrastructure components, you kill your project.
Yes.
So don't try to get a revenue stream from that, because it will kill your project.
Yes. We're fully aware of it. I don't want to discuss internal Pelagicore licensing thoughts or ideas that we do have, but we do recognize that and that differentiation should be in specific components. And it should not be, our business model is not about splitting components into an open source project only specifying the APIs, for instance, and then having all the useful stuff in a closed source binary. That's not what we're doing.
Especially inter-process communication and everything which is about infrastructure needs to be open. Otherwise, yes, you're killing it.
And that's actually what you're seeing GENIVI doing. We're going to continue to GENIVI components in a couple of slides, I think, recalling correctly. And that's the layer where GENIVI is focusing and where the open source effort is being made. But the whole Franca IDL goes well in line with the abstract component thought that you should define the interfaces of the various components in the architecture. And then this is a way to strictly define those interfaces. And given the parties involved in GENIVI, it's hard to lock down certain components just because various parties have large investments in those components, so they want to be able to use their component or some other component. Just looking at the platform from GENIVI, there are no applications in the GENIVI stack. So there is very little flashy demos of a true GENIVI stack because GENIVI does not do the user interfaces. That's where the OEM differentiates. And that's also where we spend some money on creating demos, because it's important to actually show the features of the platform. The focus is on the middleware and then adopting lower layers to that middleware. So for instance, the AF bus modification to the kernel. There are silicon vendors that are part of GENIVI, so the board support layer is affected, of course, but not part of the specification, for now at least. And just looking briefly at the components that they have. So examples of what's actually in there, we have a node startup manager, which helps systemd to make decision about which user applications to start last. Node state manager that handles all the complex states that you can have. You have multiple states when starting up, if you're partially functional, if the camera is running, not until you're fully functional. You can be in the factory, you can be in a diagnostic mode at a workshop, things like that. Just the spider in the web, keeping everything together state-wise. Diagnostic log and trace, layer manager, and audio manager, we talked about earlier. There's a user profile manager being developed because it's not as easy as logging in. It could be tied to various mechanisms to actually identify the user, and you can have handover situations. For instance, if my wife unlocks our car and turns on the radio, and I then start the car with my key, it changes all the presets, but the radio doesn't change the channel. So you can't reboot the tuner application, so to speak. It needs to be aware of the user changing context and kept running during the transition. Persistency is an interesting field because you have flash memory that has to live for 10, 15 years. You don't want every application to write to flash every time something changes. You need to control that in a centralized manner to provide an interface for that. And that also ties into the user profile management. If you have multiple user profiles, you might have multiple use sets of persistent data. And you can also have persistent data from the factory configuration options. Is this a US car? Is it an EU car? Is it an Asian car? Configuration data, basically, that needs to go through an interface up towards the applications. Then lower down in the stack, you have requirements to include AF bus for now. I think that's optional, actually. And then you have a set of kernel configuration options that are recommended, like having support for C groups and various things related to Linux containers. Then GENIVI has two baselines. There's a baseline integration team that actually builds something out of this. If it compiles, it works, you know. This is based on either Jocto or Baserock. And we work with Jocto within Pelagicore. Jocto, in turn, is based on Open Embedded, which has been around for a couple of years. It's based on having recipes for building every package. It's not a classical where you build a dev package and then install it. You have a set of recipes and you build a root system. Then you can generate a tool chain that you can be used to build further packages for that. But the core system is built in one go. What you do get out of it is a root image that you can boot on your target. You get a sysroot, which is what you need to do cross compilations. You get the cross compiler. So basically you get kit for Qt Creator. So you can create a nice environment there. And again, a link, the Jocto project. It's a really nice project actually, and they have support for interesting hardware platforms, even for hacking use.
Is it freeware?
It's open source. And you see, for instance, silicon vendors supporting it. There is a Freescale layer, there is a Raspberry Pi layer, and things like that for the different BSPs. And the whole layer concept, a layer within Jocto consists of recipes, so BB files, patches to those recipes, BB append files, and then you stack the layers in a prioritized order. In your specific project configuration, so you can tell which patches are applied in which order. So you have control. And then you basically ask it to build your image recipe, which is a BB file on the top level, pulling in your top level components, pulling in their dependencies, pulling in their dependencies, pulling in their dependencies, and you get an image that hopefully works. So just an example of what the layers you usually have. You have a base distro. There is something called Poki from Yocto, which is a minimal Linux system. You have a BSP for your hardware to actually make it boot. And then you can have layers with features or feature sets. And then you have a project configuration pointing at the various features that you do want in your image. Could also contain, for instance, the HMI, if that's tied to only that project. There is a layer maintained by GENIVI. It's called Meta IVI. It's based on the Yocto project Git, and it's a layer with the compliance component. So if you pull in the compliance specs, they're the top level components, so to speak, you get a compliant system-ish. You still need to configure the components. You might need to provide backend. For instance, for Audio Manager, you need to provide a routing decision engine, which is specific to each vehicle. But you get the basic component there. So this is a good way just to get started. Another question? Yeah. No, you need the phone.
Well, you're here, but here.
On, yeah. Maybe a stupid question, but those are the best. I've worked with AutoSAR,
yep.
With LearSAR to be specific, which is our own taste. I know that I'm getting a little bit feeling like build route and stuff like that, and this is all nice, but we also had to include deployment scenarios on which ECUs do we want to run what. That was really complex, and I'm missing just that step here.
Because you're building the whole system with the components spread over ECUs. So
yeah.
To speak. This would only be the media ECU or the media MCU the ECU doing the media. So it's not even the vehicle interface processor.
It's only on top of that the Linux based embedded. Yeah.
What you're usually doing is that you either have a separate CPU for handling the CAN buses and the critical parts.
Yeah.
And then you have your media CPU on the side. And now you have the multi-core, so you can use system hypervisors to basically run it on the same silicon, but to try to keep it separate because of the legal requirements on the vehicle interfacing part.
Of course. Okay.
Yep. Was it? Another question? I was worried about being too early.
You mentioned Qt Creator support for cross-compiling Yocto. Does that exist already? Is that in the works? Is that public?
I don't think there is a way to take it and just create a kit right out of the box, just pressing a button. But what you do get from Yocto is the sys root, which is needed, and the cross compiler.
Yeah, so, of course, but I was wondering if somebody already had created a kit out of that, because I didn't understand you correctly then, I guess.
It's just a matter of pointing them out from QtCreator. So I guess you do that when you build an installer for your specific SDK in that case. We haven't automated the process.
Okay.
But the difficult part is handled by Yocto, which is open source. So it's.
Yeah. Thanks.
Did you want to ask something? No? So, it's the Qt dev days, and I don't think I've said Qt yet. So, where does it fit? Everywhere, of course. Qt everywhere. That's the slogan. And the previous speaker sort of confirmed that as well, I thought. But we see Qt as fitting into applications, obviously. The compositor of the system is very attractive to do with Qt, since you can use a Wayland compositor in a GENIVI-based stack. And services are also nice to write with Qt. Sometimes unknown, but Qt is very convenient for writing services. Just looking at these items, Qt for applications, it's Qt Quick has made Qt the number one toolkit for custom embedded device UI, so to speak. That's my opinion. I've never found a different environment where you're that productive in actually creating a completely custom looking device UI. We can generate service proxies from Franka, just as we do for Dbus, for instance, that are easy to expose towards Qt, and to make it usable from Qt Quick, it's a matter of providing models and sometimes proxies so that you have something to bind to early instead of having to use bind instances from JavaScript. But it's really convenient, it ties well into the platform, and yeah, that's what we're doing at Pelagicore. We're also doing a compositor based on the Wayland bindings. But there is the little problem with Layer Manager. There is an extension to Wayland implemented in a GENIVI product called Western IVI, which I believe is being upstreamed or has been upstreamed. I've seen patches going forth and back. Yeah. But that shouldn't be a problem. We just wanted to settle and then reintegrate that extension into the Qt part of it. But this is the way, because then you have QML abilities in your actual compositions. You can do all the cool transitions. Then we have services. How many here has written a service in Qt? I see hands at least. That's good. Yeah, I see many hands. No, it's surprisingly efficient for doing that. You shouldn't miss this. You shouldn't think of alternate frameworks when doing services. It's so easy to do dbus servers, for instance, and we're working on having the Franca side in there as well. And then we have the Pelagicore stack. We build something on a Yocto base. We're adding services like the application manager, Tracker IVI. We add configurations for various components to make things actually do something. We have something we call application runtime environments. It could be the environment for QML applications, where we choose an API to actually expose underlying data. And then we add a set of applications on top of that to actually have something to show, since GENIVI is only middleware. And we're doing that mostly in Qt. Sometimes we have to do other things, not rewriting tracker in Qt, for instance, but staying with the pesky G objects. Pardon? I should really develop that wrapper more. The whole background for it was actually because the N900 came and Nokia bought Trolltech. And the point was to be able to port old legacy GDK applications and only have one toolkit on the hardware. And it's fairly doable. There are corner cases, of course. Our application manager is built on the Qt support for building Wayland compositors. It's hard to show it here since I don't have the demo. The cool thing is the transition when you start and change applications. A launcher screen isn't that fun. But basically, we have a component that helps audio focus, for instance. If you want to play audio on a generic level, so to speak, you're not the nav engine or the phone, it's important to know which application is on top. Is that application playing audio? Does it make sense to route that through? It helps other shared resource access arbitrations, who uses the video camera in the car, who uses the phone, whatever you have there that needs the input of the visual context, which application are you in, needs support from this component to make that decision. Then it's actually responsible for launching the applications as well. And one of the reasons for that is that we want to know that we launched the application, so that we know who is trying to show a surface. And that has to do with the legal requirements that we don't show any Wayland surface that pops up. We need to be able to trace it to something that we have started and that we trust. And the trust part means that it's also working towards installing and updating applications and maintaining that trust. This is split in multiple processes, but it's one part of the system that's hard to pick apart. When we look at the runtimes, we have the core layer, the native code or whatever. Everything runs within a container on the application level. I think that's what you need to do. Even if you don't have malicious code, you can have code crashing and you have the availability requirements on you, so you need to be able to contain the consequences and do something about it. Then we provide a Qt Quick runtime, which is meant for pure Qt Quick applications. So we have a common set of plugins providing access to various parts of the platform. But the funny thing is we can also pre-load that runtime. So we have a Qt Quick Engine gone through the linker phase or dynamic linking phase. So it's just a matter of pointing out the QML file and fire it off away. So you can get really good startup times. And in the automotive sector, you need an HTML5 story. The funny thing, Qt gives us that as well. I actually overlined WebKit and said Web Engine. We've only been using WebKit this far, but changes are coming apparently. There are vehicle data APIs being developed within GENIVI. Those APIs are targeting JavaScript. So if they settle down and actually turn out to be good, that's something you can carry over into the Qt Quick space. But as a Qt developer, you need to pick a toolkit to make a good platform integration on HTML5. There is no model concept for HTML5, for instance. You need to do a jQuery binding, an XJS, JS binding, or whatever. So there is fragmentation even within that layer that needs to be addressed, and that depends on the actual automaker. And then we have applications, and I don't mean to read through all of this. I just want to show that it's not just the launcher screen and climate control. There are lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of applications just in a basic system. We have a demo system where we showcase our knowledge and different partners that we work together with. But all of these applications make up the brand of the car, so to speak. So they have to be adapted to each and every OEM. So there is a lot of investment in software for every platform. So just to summarize, automotive, it's a conservative niche. I think you got that from a former speaker as well. They have legal requirements to adhere to. They have lots and lots and lots of standards. And GENIVI is bringing even more standards, that's true. We try to work agile. That's interesting with an organization that do 5-year waterfalls. It could be epic clashes, actually, but they recognize the needs. The OEMs we work with recognize the needs of changing their ways to be more agile, since if you start the waterfall 5, 3, or 2 years before the launch, you're old when you reach the market. At the same time, we're seeing the value chain and the ownership that is changing. We have the Electrobit Audi VAG example, for instance, where Audi is taking a bigger responsibility from the Tier 1 and having a bigger ownership in software. And we're seeing that as a problem. It's hard for the automakers to change their hardware vendors because the cost of re-implementing the software is tying them to perhaps a worse or more expensive solution. So I guess there's a tension building there until it breaks, and then you have to find a new business model or a new balance. And the funny thing is that Qt fits in very well in actually providing what automotive do need. Not the business problem, but the technical problems. So I think this is a good place for Qt to grow within. And we think GENIVI is a good place to drive that forward. And that's what's happening right now, what we're doing right now from our side and many other vendors. So I'm going to do like that. I'm going to say questions. Thank you. Another question? 2 questions?
So you mentioned you are doing that right now. I would like to know how much of Qt do we actually see in the official GENIVI stack, and how much of the stuff on top of that which you are doing do you actually see ending up in the official GENIVI stack? Because there's opposition against that as well, right, in the GENIVI
Alliance. Yeah, there's opposition.
So are you actually actively pushing, do you see any chances to get that done in the next few years, or what's the current state of getting the whole stuff you're doing into GENIVI?
Qt Core was a part of the compliance earlier and has been pushed out. But then we're seeing it being pushed back in implicitly by other requirements. So we're hoping to see it back in, but we don't see a conflict. I think the opposition to Qt is basically defending large investment in competing technologies. So it's not a matter of Qt not fitting into the picture. It's a matter of keeping Qt from being necessary for compliance because it's too good technology.
I mean, that one's clear, but do we see a chance to change that as Pelagicore or whatever support you get?
We're pushing it. And okay. We believe in it. That's why we were so eager and happy to be able to work with the Munich team from Trolltech, for instance. And they're busy. It's okay. The problem is not too much time, it's too little time. So that's good.
Thanks.
Hi, this is Arindam. I'm pretty much a newbie when it comes to GENIVI. So just when you mentioned that there are conflicts with supporting Qt on the GENIVI stack, could you explain that a little further?
GENIVI is just a big alliance of software providers. And some providers have their own solutions to the problems that Qt solve. So they don't want Qt in the compliance.
Like but some of the GENIVI members, like a famous browser?
I don't think they're a member. I'm not sure.
Norwegian
it's a big
one?
List. But there are, for instance, the classical tier ones have complete tool chains for building a statically configured UI. And they want to develop that. And they've invested many, many man years in that technology. But I think the conflict is not that Qt should be kept out. It's just that you don't want Qt to be a part of the required set of software on the platforms, or some parties do not want that. Do we have another question?
Yeah, but there is one in between here.
Oh,
thank you.
Sorry.
History has shown, and it's common sense, that if you want to have a platform which is secure, you have to design in security into the architecture right from the beginning. Adding security later, even though, of course, business people prefer to have flashy demos, is very hard or nearly impossible. And didn't you just not mention it, or is there really something lacking with regards to the complete security model, which means authentication, authorization, encryption, management of keys, management of roles, and all that stuff? Because adding it later is nearly impossible.
That in our platform for management, managing, installing, and updating, and also to show graphics, we have a chain of trust. Based on cryptology, so to speak. So we know that this is the correct package and we trust it all the way. Then within GENIVI, security is something that's handled throughout all groups. There are expert groups, and then there is a security team that's maintaining a security standards throughout the entire organization. I have not been involved in any interaction with the security team yet. I've been mostly in the HMI EG group pushing Qt, but
I have a quick add-on to.
Is that working? I think it's on.
To Orindam's question and your answer. I think the reason why GENIVI isn't in is a little bit against Qt is because they do not want any specific technology in their stack. It should be technology independent. So you can use any HMI stack. You can use the C++ standard library instead of Qt Core. And I think that's the reason why there are, once Qt Core is in, once Qt Core is out. So it's nothing sinister.
Yeah. And the consequence of that is it's not a matter of disabling Qt, so to speak. It should be possible to run Qt on top, but you don't want to exclude other solutions either. And again, that falls back to money and business reasons and investments.
I have two questions. Okay, one of them is how do you plan to handle backward compatibility? Let's say you have a very long production chains, and for example, now we switched from DBAS to EDL. Let's say the mainstream or Linux or better solutions arrive, and somebody decides it's better to switch again. And when do we find a good, will be the many revision standards and just compatible to one of them? And how to then have apps working that were working on one version now adapt to a different version?
That's one of the big challenges, but the works with GENIVI is still work in progress. So I don't think there is a big unified solution to that yet. But it's a maintenance problem, of course. If you release a new standard every 6 months and you release a new car every 5 years, you will have a number of standards to adhere to while those cars are in production and in aftermarket life. But it's hopefully the compliance standards will slow down as the platform matures. Right now they're releasing quite often because it's still early days. Did you have a second question?
I thought that was two
Two questions.
And the second question, what I'm missing looking at the components mentioned by you, even in fact, you even touched this, that you have developed this yourselves in your own GENIVI compliance solution. We have this layer manager, we have the audio manager, and there's not much marrying between video and audio within the GENIVI standard, so it's not so visible. Isn't it a little bit lacking from the platform side that we have multimedia and in fact we split it to separate interfaces and then each...
But multimedia playback is mandated to be handled through GStreamer, I believe. I think it's you need to provide the GStreamer bindings at least. And the audio routing is really a separate problem from the decoding and that part.
Yeah, but okay, so many times when you, for example, write rules for audio routing, this has to somehow be married in with the video transitions. It does you no good if you have, for example, a phone interruption on the video and you still see the video running.
Yeah, there needs to be timing, yes. But you run into that when you actually configure your rules, I guess, because there is no standard for controlling the transitions. And I guess that's OEM specific. Do you want something to pop up at the top? Do you want to take over the whole UI and so on? There are so many design decisions there, and you need to tie that into your audio routing rules and how you actually fade over or clip or cut or pause or mute or what you do.
I think we will let that be the last question inside this talk. And I'm sure that Johan will be available for tonight's party and also sure. A bit tomorrow if you have any more in-depth questions.
Off the record.
And with that in mind, thank you, Johan.